The king of pop is dead, and detectives were instructed to return to the home in which the global megastar's lifeless body was found. And when they entered Michael Jackson's private bedroom, they were aghast at what they found. Unconventional sleeping habits had always been a pattern in Michael Jackson's life. As a young child in their two-bedroom single-story home in Gary, Indiana, him and his brothers slept in a three-tier bunk bed with two brothers top-to-toe in each bed. The two older ones got to claim the top bunk, Jackie and Tito. As the brothers joked, the lower the bunk, the more likely you were to experience showers in the middle of the night from the younger brothers. When Michael started performing as part of the Jackson 5, he was on a different schedule to other children his age. Because having to perform at clubs until all hours of the night, his system became used to becoming active in the evenings into the early hours of the morning, and may have set him up with a lifelong battle with normal sleeping patterns. Once the Jackson brothers found fame and success, their schedule of long days that went into the night only intensified, and outside pressures built up for the young Michael. As they traveled, performing and touring the country, the brothers often shared their room, not only with the family, but whoever needed to crash for the night, members of the band, promoters, or A&R personnel. Therefore, Michael Jackson was never taught a structured manner to go to bed and fall asleep, taking naps on planes, tour buses, or in breaks while recording, and became accustomed to sleeping with many people around him, often in his own bed. This behavior continued well into his teens. In Michael Jackson's case, his career of performing would have naturally caused him to work at night, and he also spoke about suffering from insomnia after his concerts. Close associates reporting that it could take him up to 48 hours for his adrenaline levels to calm down and allow him to finally rest, which for Michael and his brother's constant schedule of touring, that meant the young performer became accustomed to a very limited amount of sleep. After tearing down the Jacksons' modernist Havenhurst estate in exchange for a chocolate box faux English Tudor mansion, Michael had full reign to design his first bedroom all to himself. The palatial suite of rooms included a full bathroom, dressing area, and private balcony. And when it came to his bed, Michael for a long time insisted that he would just sleep on the floor in a sleeping bag, his reasoning being that he wanted as much space as he could to practice his dancing. While working on music together, Michael gave Queen's lead singer, Freddie Mercury, a tour of his new place. But when they got upstairs, Freddie couldn't believe his eyes when he saw a mattress in the middle of the floor of his multi-million dollar mansion. Freddie said, "You've got money, why don't you just buy a bed?" And Michael just said, "I feel so much better when I'm closer to the earth." Freddie said, "Well, how much closer does not having a bed make you? We're upstairs." As a compromise, a Morphe bed was installed, which could be stowed away for maximum use of the floor space. Although Michael Jackson would soon achieve riches beyond his wildest dreams and presumably stayed in the most luxurious hotels in the world, he still treasured the safety and familiarity he felt sleeping in more humble conditions. Like he was a kid again, with all his brothers, sharing a hotel room and partaking in innocent activities like a childhood sleepover. While recording the Thriller album, the pop singer spoke about how invested him and Quincy were in the musical process, that they could work all hours of the night, often right through into the early morning, and then catching a couple hours of rest on a nearby couch before doing it all again.
We spent a lot of time laying down on the ground at midnight.
Yeah, sleeping.
18 hours a day like you're doing today?
It was more than 18.
Oh, yeah. We were sleeping out on the couch, wake up, mix it, go back to sleep, sing, wake up.
According to his longtime physician, Dr. Alan Metzgetter, this was often a part of Michael's creative process, and he was in a similar creative frenzy when he wrote We Are the World, the song that raised millions to fight famine in Africa. Like many intensely creative individuals, Michael was a night owl, and often didn't want to stop if he felt like he had something good going. Maybe at night, it was the only time he felt he had peace and clarity of thought, and that he could truly focus on his art without distraction. However, Michael Jackson's unconventional sleeping habits would for the first time come under public scrutiny, when in 1986, the National Enquirer obtained photographs of the pop singer sleeping in what appeared to be a hyperbaric oxygen chamber. According to the attached article, the publication claimed that Jackson purchased the tank because he believed it could help him live to 150 years old. The chamber was said to slow the aging process. Quote, I believe if I treat my body properly, I'll live to at least 150, the National Enquirer alleged Jackson said. Hyperbaric oxygen chambers are generally used for those with second and third degree burns, which Michael Jackson suffered with after filming a Pepsi commercial and his hair catching a light in 1984. Pepsi and Jackson would later settle out of court, and the soda company paid the singer $1 million as compensation, which he donated to the hospital that treated him. The National Enquirer alleged that Jackson used the hyperbaric chamber to improve his health and quoted the pop singer as saying, I've taken several long naps in the oxygen chamber, and when I awoke, I felt like a new person. I've never felt better. I definitely want one for my home so I can sleep in it at night. Although Adrian Garay, the president and CEO of the company that makes the said oxygen chambers, claimed that if Jackson did sleep in it, he would likely experience oxygen toxicity in his blood. Michael Jackson flat out denied the wacky rumor during his 1993 live interview with Oprah Winfrey. Jackson said to Oprah that the chamber that he was seen in was part of the Michael Jackson Burn Center that was built because of the pop singer's $1 million donation. Jackson was simply inspecting what it was like to be in the tank himself, but has never slept in an oxygen chamber.
I have been in this house getting lit and getting prepared for this, and I've been all over the house upstairs when you weren't looking, looking for that oxygen chamber. I cannot find the oxygen chamber anywhere in the house.
That story is so crazy. I mean, it's one of those tabloid things. It was completely made up. These pictures went all over the world with this lie attached to it. It's a complete lie. Why do people buy these papers and it's not the truth?
This being said, there has been many reports that Jackson and his manager, Frank DeLeo, leaked the photos himself to build more of a mysterious and larger-than-life persona for the superstar, and also as a way to promote his Lucas and Coppola's science fiction movie, Captain EO, which he starred in for Disney. In fact, not long after the Oprah interview, the leaked tabloid rumor became reality when Jackson obtained his own hyperbaric oxygen chamber. In 1994, Michael Jackson expressed interest in having his own personal chamber, Garay said. Quote, he approached Brockman Hospital, and they sold the chamber he had donated back to Michael, and it was installed in Neverland. This controversy, however, paled in comparison to the uproar that came after he was accused of crimes against children in the summer of 1993. The King of Pop's sleeping arrangements came under intense public scrutiny, as it was revealed that Jackson regularly had adolescent boys in his bedroom and even bed while visiting his Neverland ranch or joining him on tour. As previously mentioned, Michael's adrenaline levels after performing to tens of thousands of screaming fans would often take days to calm down, therefore the superstar would often suffer from chronic insomnia. As a result, Michael would occupy himself during the long sleepless nights with his traveling companions, watching old movies, playing video games, and eating junk food in bed. As described by a parent and a few of the kids themselves, they would party and have fun all night until one or more of them crashed out on a hotel couch, or their sleeping bag, or on the bed they were resting on. This intense desire to share his bedroom with others, in particular adolescent boys, may have been born out of habits that he acquired himself as a child. To escape the intense sense of loneliness and recapture his lost childhood that the pop superstar often complained about, he therefore would fill his presidential hotel suites with everything his inner child could desire, recreating the womb-like security and companionship he had in childhood touring with his brothers, years later with other children of similar ages. This uncomfortably problematic resolve to his perpetual issue sleeping only intensified as his insomnia increased in its severity. On nights that he didn't perform, he would still be up most of the night, that being what his brain was used to. His first wife, Lisa Marie Presley, claimed that she used to affectionately call him Little Troll because he would be moving around their bedroom all night long making noises. She said that sleep was something that eluded him on a regular basis, as have other people including his personal bodyguards. As legal, financial, and career pressures increased, so did the amount of public scrutiny the King of Pop was under, which gave him plenty of animation to keep him up at night. Paranoia and fearing his life settled in. Michael would always check things around the house several times a night, as though he was afraid to close his eyes. Michael would talk on the phone for an outrageous amount of time, often 3 to 6 hours, and when he felt nervous or shaky, he would doodle really nothing over and over again. A letter written by Jackson to his then wife demonstrated his frantic need for sleep. The handwritten note saying, quote, "I truly need this rest. I haven't slept in literally 4 days, and I need to be away from phones and business people. I just take care of my health first. I'm crazy for you." He signed and scribbled the note, "Love, Turd," an apparent nickname for Lisa Marie. It was in 1996, during the History World Tour, that Jackson's struggle with insomnia became more and more desperate. According to his longtime physician, Dr. Alan Metzger, the entertainer was so adrenalized, it often took days before he could sleep. Arnold Klein, Michael Jackson's longtime dermatologist, recalled Jackson not sleeping one night when he was on tour in Hawaii. Finally, Klein and his office slept in Jackson's room, Klein saying that he suffered from sleeplessness when he was under pressure. Quote, "He gets upset. He doesn't drink, he doesn't eat, he doesn't sleep. It gets to the point where he can't stand it. He is exhausted with this kind of thing." Metzger said that Jackson was able to sleep with traditional sleep medications, but then other doctors came in and overprescribed the superstar. Metzger claimed he heard from his then wife, Debbie Rowe, and two other doctors that Jackson was, quote, "doctor shopping and took pain medications that the average person wouldn't," with several doctors at hand to supply pain and sleep medications when he was traveling outside of Los Angeles. However, Debbie Rowe testified that in 1997, Metzger enlisted two doctors in Germany to administer propofol to Jackson in his hotel room, where they came equipped with monitoring equipment, and that she had a signed letter indicating that Metzger ordered the medication. This taking Michael Jackson down a dark and deadly path to help resolve his chronic sleep deprivation. Comedian Robin Williams once saying, quote, "Taking propofol to sleep is like doing chemo because you're tired of shaving your f***ing head." These medications soon took hold, and Michael Jackson's ability to sleep on his own got even more dire. This dependency even affecting the superstar's career, as he pleaded with executives at Sony not to insist on him having to tour to promote his 2001 album, Invincible, because of the complete havoc it had on his sleep, fearing the crippling exhaustion would be something that he could never recover from, or even worse. Therefore, Michael Jackson never performed or toured for many years, not until he announced in March of 2009 a final set of concerts in London titled This Is It. The stress of rehearsal and anxieties touring again quickly worsened his insomnia, which would reach intolerable heights. Michael's nurse during this period, Nurse Lee, stated she spent one night at Jackson's residence to monitor his nighttime routine. That night, the singer went to bed with classical music playing on a sound system and Donald Duck cartoons playing on the computer, surrounded by images of children and babies. He only managed to get 3 hours and told Lee, quote, "All I want is to be able to sleep. I want to be able to sleep 8 hours. I know I'll feel so much better the next day." Lee stated that Jackson told her that he believed propofol would help him, but he did not say the name of the doctor that would give it to him. Michael's reinstated manager at the time, Frank DeLeo, believed that Jackson didn't have that much of a sleeping problem, but he used to use that as an excuse to continue to take his, quote, "milk," or propofol, in which the Jackson referred to as milk because of its milky consistency, that he liked the way that it made him feel upon awaking. However, when DeLeo addressed this with Michael, they had an argument, and the glove one proclaimed that other drugs prescribed to him didn't help much or not at all. The drug propofol gives a sense of euphoria when waking up, and for some people, hallucinations that seem like they're dreaming. An opioid addiction, which Michael Jackson had, in itself causes insomnia, psychiatric problems, especially OCD, anxiety, depression, and paranoia, all of which Michael Jackson suffered from, can cause insomnia as well. So while having difficulty sleeping in a normal sleep cycle, Michael also took caffeine pills as a post-insomnia morning pick-me-up, which in itself would cause again insomnia. A big reason why Michael Jackson could not sleep was not only the drugs, but the inappropriate mixing of drugs. However, while the patient on propofol appears to be sleeping, they don't in fact experience REM sleep, or rapid eye movement sleep. And no REM sleep causes a sleep disorder, which can potentially kill a person if untreated. Jackson may be the only person to have ever gone 2 months without REM sleep, which is vital to keep the brain and body alive. The 60 nights of propofol infusions Dr. Conrad said that he gave Jackson to treat his insomnia is something a sleep expert says no one has ever undergone. Studies showed that similar levels of sleep deprivation resulted in deaths in laboratory animals and would likely cause death of a human. Michael Jackson's inability to learn new dance moves and remember lyrics to songs that he had sung for years were symptoms that the singer was totally sleep deprived by the time of his death. Charles Silaisa, a Harvard Medical School sleep expert, said reports by workers on Jackson's ill-fated comeback concerts that the entertainer was losing weight, talking to himself and hearing voices, exhibiting signs of paranoia, and his condition seemed to be deteriorating. Quote, "The symptoms that Mr. Jackson was exhibiting were consistent with what someone might expect to see in someone suffering from total sleep deprivation over a chronic period," he reported. After Michael Jackson's untimely death on June 25, 2009, the bedroom he took his last breaths in was inspected and intensely scrutinized. Medications, post-it notes with scrawled messages, piles of books, pictures of babies and dolls were found. Detective Scott Smith observing, quote, "I just remember going in there and there was an IV stand, a saline bag, and just various medications spawn about. In the room where he was being treated, it did not seem like a room fit for any type of medical treatment. It was like a home makeshift medical suite." The detectives also described discovering Dr. Murray's medical bag hidden in the property, which first arose their suspicions of foul play. Quote, "We found a bunch more medications that were used, like propofol. We found all the waste, all the trash, the needles, the empty bottles, the stuff like that when we went into the room, which should have been just laying there." Coming to the conclusion that, quote, "We knew that sometime during the medical emergency, Dr. Murray had stopped either giving CPR or waited to give CPR and cleaned everything up." With the final conclusion being, quote, "Within 48 hours, it appeared to be a suspicious death in that there was something more than just an overdose."